All right, good morning, everybody. So a quick announcement. The assignment 4 came out over the weekend. It's actually relatively short. There's only 3 questions on it. The third question is very slightly longer than the other two. Hopefully after today's lecture, you'll be able to do, after today's lecture, you should be able to do everything on the assignment. At least that's the goal. I did move the due date a couple of days, so I think it's due. It's more than a week, anyway. You have more than a week to do it. The goal for today is to get through types, including arrays, and hopefully talk about a little bit about how to do math in C. There's not much you need to know specifically about math in C, but you do need to know how to compile a program that uses the standard C math library. All right, so we ended up on this slide last lecture. And we were talking about the types, the basic arithmetic types that you have access to in C, right? There's a lot more of them in C compared to Java, right? One of the notable differences between Java and C is that your built-in types in C, they have no defined sizes. So you don't know how big an int is in memory, there's no guarantee on how big an int is in memory, right? Or a long, or a double, and so on and so on and so forth, right? Whereas in Java, Java says specifically an int is 32 bits and so on and so on and so forth. Another one of the big differences is that in C, you have unsigned integer types, right? In Java, all your integer types are signed, so they can be negative or positive. In C, you can have unsigned types, so any value, a value that's between 0 and some maximum value, or a signed type. So a value that's between is negative or positive, again, between some minimum and maximum value. If you want to find out the actual number, the actual size of a type in C, there's an operator called size of. So this little program here prints the size of many, but not all, of the integer types. Right. And if you run that, if you run that little program, you get the following output right there. Right. So in C, all sizes are multiples of car. Right. So if you print out the size of car on your computer, it's always 1, regardless of the regardless of your computer architecture or operating system. Right. Int. On my computer, an int is 4, so it's 4 times as big as a car. Right, and a double is 8 times as big as a car, and a pointer, regardless of what it points at, is 8 times as big as a car. Right? If you're curious as to what your computer is actually using, if you go to, there's a link in the previous lecture about the arithmetic types, right? So that takes you to this page up here. If you scroll down to the table here, you'll see that. The width in bits by data model, right? First column, you'll see the C standard that says how big these things are, right? So your car are at least 8 bits. And then you've got 4 columns here that tell you exact number of bits depending on your computer architecture. This is Windows 32. Most of you probably aren't using this. That's Windows 64, which is probably most of your computers now if you're using Windows. That's 32-bit Linux, and that's 64-bit Linux. Did I get that right? LP64. The descriptions are down here. Yeah. Right. So if you're on a Mac, if you're on a modern Mac, you'll be in the fourth. You'll be in that column out there. Notice that most of the architectures use the same number of bits for the types. Right. So there aren't that many. Here's a difference right here. Right. So 32-bit Windows uses 16-bit ints. All the other types, all the other major desktop architectures use 32 bits. So that's one of the issues that you have to deal with in C. If you're trying to write a program that runs on multiple operating systems, you can run into the problem where one of the types that you're using has a different size depending on what architecture you're using. There are ways to work around this problem. For our purposes, they're not relevant right now. What else do I want to? Oh. This used to be a bigger concern longer ago, right? So back in the early days of computing, there were many different hardware manufacturers. They would all build their CPUs with a different architecture. So someone might use 18-bit ints, for example, or 18-bit, their native word size might be 18 bits on their computer. So you'd have 18-bit ints, for example, right? Nowadays, there's really only a few major hardware manufacturers. And so this is less of an issue now. Okay, where are we? Here. Where is that slide? Here? Okay. Okay. Now, one of the unusual things in C is that there is no built-in type for true or false. Right? So the original version of C just used int for true-false. Zero corresponds to false, and anything else corresponds to true. Right? And so the C99 introduced the type underscore big B bool. Right? If you ever see an underscore in something in C, that means it's a new feature. It basically means it's a new feature to the language, right? So the type underscore bool, that was a new type that was added to the language, right? The way this thing works is you can assign it any value, right? So if you assign it the value 0, it's false. Anything else causes it to be true. So any other numeric value causes it to be true, right? And then the compiler converts it to zeros and ones. Right, so anything that you want to be false gets converted to a zero. Whoops, zero. Anything that you want to be true ends up getting converted to one internally. Right, if you want to use this type instead of plain old int, you have to include that header file right there. You don't have to include that header file. If you want to use the Boolean type instead of int, right, you can use include standard bool, and then you get the names bool instead of underscore big bool. And you get false and true. Right? So if you want to use true, false, and bool in your programs, just include standard bool, and then you get something that looks like more modern logical type. Right? Everything works the same as in Java. Right? So not, and or. Right? So here's a little program that uses bool. Right? So I'm not including standard bool here. I'm going to use the type underscore big B bool. Right, I've got a variable called flag. I'm going to set it to 0, so that means false. Right, if that thing is true, it's going to print true. Otherwise, it's going to print false. Obviously, if you run this program, right, this prints false. I guess I should pull it up here. Hopefully, it's here. Cat boo, I think. Yes. Okay, so compile. Right, run. So it prints true. Right, if you go in and change that, this is using bool. Do I have the other one here? It's print boo. Well, we can go in and change it, it's fine. Okay, so let me change true to, so I could use one, but I'm gonna do something weird. I'm gonna do 1.99. Oh, sorry, hang on. Right, which looks very weird. Recompile, run it again. It's going to print true again. Right, so any numeric value that's not zero gets converted to true. Right, which can lead to, which if you're not careful, can lead to unusual bugs. Right, so for example, if you assign a double value to that accidentally, the compiler doesn't tell you you're doing anything weird. Simply accepts what you've written, right? And now you end up converting that double value to a Boolean value, right? Which is unusual, but I guess there might be some situation in which you want that to happen. Here's the actual program there. All right, so this one uses standard bool and then the type bool. Now, one of the annoying things you have to work around with when you're using bool is that it's a new type. When they added the type to the language, they did not give you a way to print out the value true or false. Right? So if you try to use our formatted print function to print the Boolean value, if you actually look at the documentation for printf, you'll see that there is no special conversion for Booleans. Right? So you have to convert it using an integer conversion. right? Or that would be the way you'd normally print it, right? So if I have a Boolean value true and I'd like to print it out, right? One way to do it is to print it out as a integer value, right? You can use D, you can use I, or in this case, you can use U. Percent %U means unsigned. So this is unsigned integer. If you run this program, this one's gonna print one. It'll always print one for true, right? And it'll always print zero for false, right? Which is a bit inconvenient if you're printing stuff to the screen for debugging purposes, right? It might be nice to see true or false. Unfortunately, there's no easy way to do it. You end up having to do something gross like this, right? So if you wanna print out the string true or false, right, then you can try to format the value as a string, right? If you just use the flag, that's gonna give you back zero or one again. So what you need to do is you need to put in some logic that converts flag to a string yourself, right? You could put in an if statement and create a string variable and then store and then run the if statement to compute whether or not you want the string true or false. This is the ternary operator, in C. It exists in Java as well, right? So it consists of a question mark and a colon, right? The way you read this thing is, right, you look at that condition, so that's a condition, right? Something that's true or false, right? If that thing is true, then you end up with that value there, right? If this thing is false, then you end up with that value there. So what all of this ends up evaluating to, right? So if the flag is true, all of this gets replaced with the string true, right? If the flag is false, then all of this gets replaced with the string false, right? And now that prints out the string true or false, right? Awkward, but that's what you have to live with in C. All right, so char in C means the same, roughly means the same thing as char in Java, right? So it's the type that's used to represent individual characters of a string. Right. In C, char is the smallest addressable unit of the machine. So and all that means is that the smallest piece of data that you can address as one piece of data is char in C. Right. And so usually it's 8 bits. So on that table that I showed you on all desktop computing architecture, all of the common desktop computer architectures, char is 8 bits. If you want to know how big is it actually on your computer, you can include that header file and look at the value char bit. So just like in Java, a char literal is any single character inside of single quotes. Right? It can also be what's called an escape sequence. So these are the, are these all of them? I don't remember if this is all of them or not. I think these are all of them. So an escape sequence is something that's used to print out a quote-unquote unusual character, or a character that you can't put into a string literal on its own, right? So if you wanted a double quote inside of a string literal, right, you have to write backslash double quote, right? Because double quotes are used to indicate the start and the end of the literal, right? If you want an actual double quote, you need some special way to indicate that you've got a double quote, right? So this is similar to the backslash the escape in Bash, right? Single quote is backslash single quote. Surprisingly, question mark needs a backslash in C because there are the things called trigraphs. Google trigraph if you want to know what it is. They're very uncommon. If you want a backslash, then it's backslash backslash, right? The rest of these are the rest of these are either non-printing or if they print, there's some kind of white space. So backslash T is your tab character, and backslash N is your new line character, right? On many of your computers, these won't do anything. So if you try to print out backslash A, that doesn't always ring the bell on your computer. Right? Otherwise, char is more or less the same as in Java, right? Doesn't mean the exact same thing, because in Java, char means something, char is a Unicode character. That's not the case in C. We'll talk more about that when we talk about strings, though. Okay, so like Java, C has enumerations, but the enumeration type that you have in C is very primitive compared to Java. C only has integer enumerations. So what that lets you do is if you have a set of constants, it lets you give a number to each constant. Right, so for example, the enumeration day, right, brace, and then brace. So the names, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, these are names of the type enum day. Right? Now your compiler is just going to treat these as integers. Right? So even though you've got this type enum day, it doesn't actually define a proper type in C. It's just an integer. Right? Sunday gets the value 0, Monday gets the value 1, Tuesday gets the value 2, and so on and so on and so forth. Right? Enum compass defines the four compass directions, so north, east, west, and south. South and west, I guess. You're allowed to assign any integer value to the constant, with the caveat that the numbers that you assign must be unique. Right? So north, this corresponds to 0 degrees, right? East is 90 degrees, south is 180, and west is 270 degrees on a compass. Right? And then finally, we've got the month, right? If you write January equals 1, then that assigns the value 1 to January. Everything else, right, doesn't have a value after it, so it starts counting from 1. So February is 2, March is 3, and so on and so on and so on, till December, which is 12. Right, now in your program, you can use the type enum day and create a variable whose type is enum day. Right, so enum day d, and then you can assign it one of these constants up here. Right, now the problem with the C enumerations is you can assign any integer value here. Right, so it doesn't have to be one of these, right? So you could write enum day d equals December, and as far as your compiler is concerned, that's just fine, right? You can write enum day d equals minus 99, and again, as far as your compiler is concerned, that's just fine, right? So the enumeration type in C is very primitive compared to what you get in Java or Python, right? And again, these are just integer values. So if you print them out, you don't get like Sunday or Friday or November, right? What you end up with is a number. I have to compile it. So again, I'm going to compile enum C, so GCC minus O, enum, and then the name of the program. And when you run it, right, you get 10, 180, and 10, which is not super helpful, right? You would really like to see what is 10? 10 doesn't make sense, right? For the days? Yeah, there's only 7 days, but notice that you can, in fact, assign the value 10 to the day, right? Which I did right there. Right. So again, the type, even though there is an enumeration type, it's really not type safe. It's really just a thin wrapper around int. All right, now there's also the type void in C, which means something similar in Java. Right, so on its own, void means cannot hold any value. Right, and so that's similar to a void method in Java. Right, a void method in Java returns no value. Right, so you can have a void function in Java, which means the function returns no value. Inside the parameter list, if the parameter list is simply void, that means it's a function that has no parameters, right? Expects no arguments. There's also a pointer to void, right? So a pointer to void means that the pointer can point at any object, right? So remember, if you wanted a pointer to int, normally you'd write int star and then some pointer name, right? If you create a void pointer, you can make that pointer point at whatever you want, right? So here's a little program. We've got an int value x, right? Its value is 1. I'm now going to make a pointer, so a void pointer, right? So void star p. I can make this point at whatever object I want it to. So I can make it point at x if I like, right? I just take the address of x, right? Store the address of x in p, and that works just fine, right? If I want to print out the value of p, right, I can use printf, right, percent %d for the conversion, so convert as a base 10 number, backslash n, so print a new line after printing the number, right? And I can now get the value of p, right? Now, how do you get the value of p if it's a void pointer, right? So I need to, well, in this case, I'm going to cast p to a pointer to int, right? So that's what this round bracket int star means, right? So round bracket int star round bracket p tells the compiler treat p as though it were a pointer to int, right? Round bracket, right? So everything in the round brackets is now a pointer to int, so I can now dereference that pointer and get an int value out of it, right? Right, so one more time, right? P is a void pointer. So it turns out you can't dereference a void pointer, right? So in other words, after once I write this line here, so void star p equals the address of x, right? I cannot write star p anywhere. So I can't. You're not allowed to dereference a void pointer. The reason you can't dereference a void pointer is because the compiler doesn't know what that thing is pointing at, right? Remember, a pointer is just an address. If you tell the compiler that the pointer is a void pointer, you're simply telling the compiler that you've got a pointer p, it's pointing at something, but it doesn't know what it's pointing at. To dereference a value, the compiler needs to know what is the type that the thing is pointing at, right? A void pointer, you lose that information, so you can't dereference the void pointer directly, right? So instead, you have to cast it to something. So I have to cast it to a pointer to int in this case, and then dereference it. If I have the value y, I can recycle the pointer p and now make p point at y, right? So here p was pointing at an int, now it's pointing at a double. To print out the double, right, the conversion is %lf, right? F is for floating point, l is the modifier that you are supposed to use if you have a double value. Backslash n, so new line after printing the value, right? I want to print the value that p is pointing at. P is pointing at a double, so P is pointing at a double value, so I have to cast the pointer to double star, right? Then I have to take that whole thing and dereference it. Hopefully, where is this one? Const enum print. Is it here? It may not be here. Sorry. I don't think it's here. Okay, so it doesn't look like I have that program handy. But if you run it, this will in fact print out the value 1 and 2.0 here, right? When you do the cast, right? So the first time I cast p, right? I know that p, I wrote the program, so I happen to know that p is pointing at an int value, right? So I can cast it to int star here. You can cast this to whatever you want, right? So you can tell the compiler this, hey, this is pointing at a car if you wanted to, right? So you could write car star here. And the compiler will believe you, right? So C compared to other language, well, in this case, C is very permissive in what it lets you do, right? If you've got a void pointer, P, you can tell the compiler that that thing points at whatever you want, right? So you can cast that to a car. When you dereference it, it'll try to dereference that value as though it were a car, right? And then it'll print it using that car value. In this case, you'll still get 1 because 1 fits inside car. If you choose a different value and choose a different cast here, you could get a different result, right? Oh, sorry. All right, finally, arrays. One of the things you should have noticed is that I haven't talked about strings yet, and that's intentional. To talk about strings, I have to actually tell you what an array is in C first. Right. Okay, so an array in C is similar to an array in Java. Right, so it's a fixed size collection of values. Right, the language says that that collection is a contiguous sequence of objects. Right, contiguous sequence of objects just means that each element in the array, if you look at them in memory, they're laid out one after the other in memory. Right, so first element, then right beside it is the second element, then right beside it is the third element. I guess that's true enough for now, right? And the array takes up one big chunk of memory, right? In an array, in C, all of the elements have the same type. The number of elements, or the size of the array, or the length of the array, if you prefer, it never changes during the lifetime of the array, right? So once you make an array, just like in Java, you cannot change the size of that array, right? The type of an array is related to the type of the element, also like Java, Right? And again, finally, like Java, use the square brackets to access the individual elements. Right? Unlike Java, if you happen to know, when you create the array, creating the array is different in Java compared to creating an array in C. Right? So that first line there, so int x square bracket 3 says that x is an array of int. In this case, it's an array of 3 ints. Right? So int x square bracket is the array type. To access the elements of the array, you just use the square brackets with an integer index. The index must be non-negative, starts at 0. Right? So also like Java. Right? X 0, so the first element of x is 1, second element of x is 2, third element of x is 3. Right? There is a little loop that prints, and this will print out the elements of the array, each element on one line. So printf %d, right? Treat that argument, as an int, right? Print it out, and then add the new line character after printing it out, right? So that prints out each element on one line. That'll print out 1, 2, 3. Right. All right. So I'm going to tell you this once, and then I'm never going to tell you this again, and I'm going to also tell you never do this. Okay. So if you want to know the size of an array, right? Then you can use size of, right? So size of, and then some array here, returns the amount of memory that is used by the array, right? So that's equal to the number of elements in the array times the size of each element, right? So for example, there is an array of 3 ints, right? If I ask for the size of that array, right, using size of, that's going to tell you it's 3 times however big an int is on your computer. Right? So if you want the number of elements, right, there is no way to get the number of elements of an array in C. Right? So in Java, you can just write the array name dot length. C is strange in that it does not keep the size, never keeps track of the size of the array. Right? So remember that. If you have an array, either the programmer has to know how big that array is on their own. There is no way to get the size of the array, right? Unless you declare it like this, right? So if you declare an array, a local array like this, right, then you can use size of, right? To get the number of elements, it's the total size of the array divided by the size of the element type. Right? So this will tell you the number of elements in the array, right? So that thing there is going to be equal to 3 in this program here. Now, hopefully I have this program kicking around somewhere. So this is probably array 2. More or less. Okay. Whoops. Okay. So the size of the array, right, is equal to 12 units of memory, right? So there's 3 elements in the array. An int on my computer, 4 units of memory, right? So 3 times 4 is 12. Right? The number of elements in the array, or the capacity, right, is the total size of the array, which is 12, divided by size of int, which in this case is 4. Right, and so that gives you 3 in this case. All right, now, remember this, okay? You can only do this, right, if you have if you declare the array in the same function in which you're trying to find the size of that array. Right, so here x is local to the function main, right? The way it's declared is with this syntax up here. Right? Only in this circumstance can you use size of and divide by the size of the element type to get the number of elements in the array. Right? This is the only circumstance in which you can do this. Right? In a few lectures, we're going to look at a different way of allocating a block of memory that serves as an array. Right? When you do that, this technique here no longer works. Right? Furthermore, if you were to write another function up here, and if you pass the array x to that other function, in that other function, you cannot write that and have it work correctly, right? So I'm going to suggest you forget about this, even though I've told you about it, right? I'm going to suggest you forget you can do this, right? Because this is going to get you into trouble if you try to do this just to get the length of the array, right? It really doesn't make sense to do this here because you know the length of the array right here, right? So the correct way to do this is make a variable to store the length of the array and then use the variable to specify the size of the array, right? And now you can carry around the length of the array with you. If you're going to write a function that takes if you're going to write a function that requires an array as input, you either have to tell the function how long is the array, so you have to add an extra parameter to the function, right? Or you need to use a special value in the array to indicate that the end of the array. Right? We're going to look at that in greater detail in a later lecture. For the purposes of the assignment, you always know the size of the array. Right. So in your assignment, question three, you know that your array size is always 8 in that case. Right. So once again, be very careful if you find yourself writing this. There's a pretty good chance that that's not what you want to write, right? Or that won't give you the correct result. All right. So if you have an array and you're declaring it like this, so you're making a little local array, and you happen to know the elements that you want in the array, you can use an initialization list. So brace, and then commas separating the elements. Right? So again, this is similar to Java. Right? You don't have to specify the size here. Right? The compiler will infer the size from the size of the initialization list. Right? So this makes an array X. Its length is 3. Its values are 1, 2, and 3. If you specify the size of the array, you are still allowed to use an initialization list, right? The initialization list is either contains 5 elements or less than 5 elements, right? It cannot contain more than 5 elements, right? So this makes an array of length 5. It sets the first 3 values to 1, 2, and 3. All remaining values are set to 0, right? So if you print that out, you get 1, 2, 3, 0, 0. All right, so finally we get to strings. So there is no string type in C, right? So that's weird, right? Especially coming from Python and Java, right? Python and Java have their own proper string types, right? The string types in Java and C are quite powerful, right? You can do lots of things with strings. That's not the case in C. So in C, a string is just an array of car, right? Furthermore, the last character in the array is the numeric value 0, right? Now, the numeric value 0 written as a character, right, as a character literal, right, is backslash 0, right? So the numeric value 0 as a character as a char literal is backslash 0, right? It is not plain old 0, right? Plain old 0 is the printable version of 0, right? Which is not the same as the numeric value 0, right? So that's the numeric value backslash 0, right? So an array in char, a string in C is just an array of char. And there's a hidden, what's called a null terminator or null character, whose value is backslash 0. Right. So here's that's a string in C. Right. Notice it's kind of gross. Right. It's just an array of car. Right. Double quotes indicates a string literal. Now, when you write a string literal, you don't have to put in the backslash 0 yourself. Right. The compiler will do it for you. Right? So this is the string big CISC 220, and then hidden from you can't see it, there's a backslash 0 after that last 0. So the length of this string is actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 characters. Right? That array there is actually 8 long. Right? It's not 7, it's 8. Right? If you print the string using %s as the conversion, that just prints out sys220. Right? And then the backslash n means new line. Let me just quickly jump ahead. Okay, so a string in C is just an array, right? And so that means if you want to do any operations on a string in C, right, you either do it by manipulating the array, right, or you can use one of these standard library functions that accepts a string, right? Now, all of the standard library functions that accept a string require that null terminator to be at the end of the string. So if you make an array and you populate the array yourself manually and you forget that \0, when you pass that string to a C function, that function's probably going to barf. It's probably going to do something strange. Yeah, question at the back. Are bash strings terminated with a \0? Is that your question? So as far as bash is concerned, the answer is no. But the bash is probably implemented in C, so internally, all the strings are probably null terminated. Yeah. But as far as bash is concerned, no. All right, so we're going to come back. There's going to be like a complete lecture or two that talk about strings in greater detail. All right, so you've got an array. Now, in C, the name of the array is synonymous with a pointer to the first element of the array. Okay? So in other words, the name str, right, you can think of that as being a pointer to the first C. Right? So if you use just the name str on its own, that's equivalent to a pointer to the first C in this string. Oops, sorry. The subscript operator, so the square brackets, right, is synonymous with what's called pointer addition followed by dereferencing. I'm going to talk more about pointer addition in a later lecture, but I'm going to show you what it looks like here. All right, here's my array of car, right, called str. Right, now remember the name str, right, is synonymous with a pointer to the first element of the array. Right, so I can use str and store the value of that in a pointer to car. Right? So in other words, I can write car star p equals str, and that works just fine. Right? Now, there's a difference here. Right? Str is an array. P is not an array. Right? P is a pointer to car. So these are two distinct things. Right? P happens to be pointing at the first character of that array. Right? But P itself is not an array. Right? Okay. So I've got a pointer now, right? What can you do with a pointer? Well, you can dereference the pointer, right? And then assign a value to that dereferenced pointer, right? So I can dereference p, right? Now, what does that do? That gives me the object that p is pointing at, right? So that gives me the car, right, in this array, right? It gives me the first car in that array, so it gives me the big C, right? I can change its value, right, to little c. So writing that causes that C to be reassigned to the lowercase c. Right? So one more time, right? The name str is synonymous with the pointer to the first character or the first element of the array. Right? So I can make a pointer p, assign the value str to it, and that says that p points at the big C right here. P is just a pointer, so I can dereference it and assign a value to the dereferenced object. Right? So in other words, dereference P, so that gives me the character in the first element of the array. And then I can assign it a value, so that overwrites the first element of the array with a lowercase c. Right? If you were to print out that string, you would get little c isc 20. Right? Okay, if you have a pointer, you can add an integer value to that pointer. So p plus 1, right? And if I dereference that value, is the same thing as writing P square bracket 1 in this case. I guess I should have written, well, it's fine, P square bracket 1. Right? So if P is a pointer, right, to some, P is a pointer to a value, then adding an integer value to the pointer, right, is the same thing as using an index and treating the pointer as though it were an array. Right? So P plus 1 is the character after whatever character P is pointing at. Right? P is pointing at the big C. So P plus 1 is the pointer pointing at the I. Right? P plus 2, so P points at the C, plus 2 is the pointer that points at the S. Right? P plus 3 is the pointer that points at the second C. Right? If you dereference that pointer, right, that changes and assign a value to it, right? That simply overwrites whatever that pointer, that overwrites the object that the pointer is pointing at. Right? So star P plus 1 equals I changes the big I to little I. Star P plus 2 equals S changes the capital S to little s. And then star P plus 3 equals C changes the second C to lowercase c. Right? And so notice that with pointers, you also get pointer arithmetic. Right? You can subtract a value from a pointer too. Okay, so I can take another pointer. So let me take the pointer Q and make it point at the 2. Right? Let me write this on the board. So I can do car star Q. Right? So car star, so a pointer to a car. Right? And I would like to make it point at the 2. Right, and so there's lots of ways I can do this, but one of the things I can do is I can write str plus 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, str is a pointer to the first C. Add 4, so move 4 characters to the right, and that points at the first 2. Right, and now if I write, so now you can do lots of things here. So I can write q0. Equals 3. Right? So I can treat Q as though it were an array. Right? So Q square bracket 0 changes whatever Q is pointing at to the, can I actually do, yes, I can do that, to a 3. Right? Or I guess I'm staying consistent with what's on the board, on the slide. Right? Star Q equals 3. Right, dereference the pointer and overwrite the object that's pointed at. Okay, so we're coming, there's going to be, again, in the future, so in a few lectures, there's going to be another lecture where we talk about pointers in greater detail. Yeah, question? Yeah. Why are we using P instead of the name of the array? It's the same thing in both cases. In this case, so if str1 is the same thing here. Yep. All right, so just like in Java. Oh, wait, sorry, not like in Java, sorry. In Java, if you have an array and you use an index, if the index is invalid, you get an index out of bounds exception. Right? The same thing happens in Python, right? If you use an invalid index in Python, you get a value error. Do you get a value error? I don't know what the exception is in Python. I don't do enough Python programming, but you get an exception. There's no array index bounds checking in C, right? If you use an invalid index in C in an array, something happens. Whether that something is good or bad, well, it's never good. Whether it causes your program to crash, you have no idea, right? It may or may not, right? So you're really going to miss the fact that you have no exceptions here in C, right? So index bounds are never checked in C, right? If you use an index on an array in C, the compiler assumes you know what you're doing, right? It's simply going to try to access that value, right? So if you use an invalid index, if you're really lucky, your program crashes and then you know there's a problem. If you are unlucky, right? And you're writing into that index, right? Then what ends up happening is whatever is in memory is being pointed at by that index gets overwritten. If there was something important there, it's now gone, right? If you're lucky, there was nothing important there, and your program doesn't crash, right? But whatever it is you just thought you did, you didn't really do, right? So you have to pay very careful attention to your indexes when you are working with arrays in C. So here's an example. So here's, again, my string 6 to 20. I'm going to take a pointer. I'm going to make a pointer, make it point at the first character of the array. So it's going to point at the C, right? Overwrite it with the lowercase c. Right? Now, this string has length. The largest index I can use with the string is 7, right? Because it's 7? Sorry, 0, 6. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? That's the largest index. If I take that pointer and I add 100,000 to it, right? So go to the C, right? Now in memory, go 100,000 cars to the right, right? And whatever is there, I'm going to stick in a question mark, right? And then try to print that string, right? Does it work? Well, who knows? Let's see. Hopefully I have this program here, or I have it handy. Cat string 2, string 3. No. I don't think it's, no, it's 4 is not here. Sorry. I'm just going to quickly try to see if it's here. Pointers? No, not pointers either. Well, that sucks. Sorry, I don't have it handy. I'll run this in the next lecture. We're almost done for today anyway. Right? So the compiler here is going to trust that you know what you're doing, right? So when you write this line here, the compiler doesn't actually check, can you go 100,000 elements to the right of P, right? It's simply going to try to go 100,000 elements to the right of P and then stick in a question mark, right? The reason this happens is, or the reason why there is no bounds checking in C, right? It's because C doesn't keep track of how big your arrays are, right? There's no mechanism in C to keep track of the size of an array, right? Here, when you make the array, right, it has size 8, right? 7 characters in the string plus the null terminator. So there's a chunk of memory that can hold 8 cars, or at least 8 cars, right? But nowhere is the fact that that thing, that array can hold 8 characters, is that kept anywhere? Right? And so there's no way for the compiler to check, is this index, is this pointer arithmetic here, is this correct or not, or is it valid or not? Right? It's simply going to try to do it, and then something will happen. Right? Now, let's stop there. So I really want to run this example for you. So I'm going to stop there and get set up to run that example, and then we'll pick this up in the next lecture.